BattleTech Chronicles, books 4 through 6.
BattleTech.
Blood Legacy, Blood of Kerensky, Volume 2, by Michael A. Stackpole, performed by Christopher Graybill.
Living memory could not tell the last time all the key leaders of the Inner Sphere sat together. But old blood feuds and power struggles must be put aside if the successor states are to have any hope of defeating the invading clans and their superior battle mechs. The very man asking for their trust freely admits to being a former clansman himself. And yet another threat hides in their very midst, in the ambitions of the Comstar sect that controls interstellar communication. A decision for action cannot wait. Wolf's Dragoons General Headquarters, Outreach March, Federated Commonwealth, 15 January, 3051. Victor Ian Steiner Davion sat stunned in his chair in the Dragoons Grand Council chamber. In front of him, his father, Hans Davion, sat in shock.
By all the gods of heaven, I can't believe it.
Jamie Wolf looked around at the assembled leaders of the Inner Sphere, who gazed back at him with rapt attention.
More than 45 years ago, Wolf's dragoons were sent by the clans to determine the level of military preparedness of your states, those fragments of what had once been the Star League. Since that time, we have worked both for and against every one of the great houses of the Inner Sphere.
Prince Hakon Magnusson of the Free Razalhag Republic angrily raised a clenched fist.
Then I have you to blame for the clans half-devouring my nation!
Wolf held up his hand to forestall other shouted questions.
Stop. You misinterpret my words. The Dragoons had nothing to do with the clan's choice of targets. They are merely following the same route back into the Inner Sphere by which they left it. The Free Razalhag Republic just happens to inhabit that slice of known space.
Prince Hans Davion rose from his seat with the ease of a much younger man.
Colonel Wolf, I gather by your answer to Prince Magnusson that you are no longer associated with the clans?
Wolf nodded.
Our last communication with the clans occurred just after the Marek Civil War in 3014. At that time, our leader believed that a clan invasion of the Inner Sphere was a distinct possibility. Even so, we were ordered to cease communicating information back to the clans. Since then, we have had no contact with them until their recent broadcast informing us of the death of the Eokon.
Romano Liao, the Chancellor of the Capellan Confederation, sprang to her feet.
Ha! You have all clasped a viper to your breast so long that you cannot see Wolf for what he is!
A slender young man seated behind her rested his hands on her shoulders and eased her back into her seat. Victor's blue-gray eyes narrowed as he studied Romano's son, Sun Tzu. He did not have the wild look around the eyes that marked his mother as seriously disturbed. The tales of paranoid rages and other lunacy from the court in Xian were so rife that Victor took Sun Tzu's very survival to mean he was both intelligent and politically astute. Victor glanced over to where the St. Ives Compact delegation was seated. Despite Romano's protests, Wolf had accorded the Compact full rights of a sovereign nation. The Dragoon leader had stated that Candace Liao, Romano Liao's sister, was the ruler of an independent state of the Inner Sphere, even though the Capellans still claimed the realm as occupied territory. Behind Candace sat Kai, her eldest son, and her twin daughters, Cassandra and Quan Yin. To Victor, the biggest difference between Kai and Sun Tzu was that Kai's eyes lacked the hungry gleam that flashed from Sun Tzu's. Perhaps it was because Kai, older than Sun Tzu, could press a more convincing claim to the throne Sun Tzu so coveted. Hans Davion, still on his feet, cleared his throat.
I must disagree with Chancellor Liao's assessment of the situation. As my intelligence secretary can confirm, there has been no overt or covert contact between the clans and Wolf's Dragoons since they took up residence here on Outreach 20 years ago.
I would agree that the Dragoons had ample opportunity for treachery in this situation, but I would more have expected some of us to try to kill one another.
Theodore Carita, warlord of the Draconis Combine, steepled his fingers as he spoke.
Here we are all together, and as nothing untoward has yet occurred, perhaps it would be more productive to assume we have not been betrayed.
As Theodore spoke, Victor studied Theodore's eldest son, Hohiro. Hohiro had the fierce, noble features of his father, and Victor felt a jolt when their stares met. The younger Davion could not suppress a grin.
He's just like me. Our fathers have hated each other for as long as they've been alive. Now that legacy falls to us.
Jamie Wolfe looked up from his podium at another contingent of royals from the inner sphere.
You are the last to speak, Captain General. Are you in a trap, or can the dragoons be trusted?
Though Thomas Merrick did not rise to speak, he was an imposing figure. He wore a purple uniform, but without rank insignia. Over his graying hair, he wore a short cap. Sophina, Thomas's wife, also wore one, as did Joshua Simon, all of 5 years old, who sat holding his mother's hand. The boy's uniform imitated his father's, while the cap hid his baldness. Against the dark-colored uniform, Joshua seemed even more pallid, his eyes sunk deeply in shadow. Victor's aide, Galen Cox, sucked in a sharp breath.
It's true, then. The child is very ill.
Justin's sources report leukemia. Victor shook his head in pity. The prognosis is not good.
Thomas Merrick leaned forward, resting his hands on the table assigned to the Free Worlds League.
I share Carita's view that worrying about a trap is immaterial at this point. The Dragoons have brought us here to discuss the clan invasion and what we should do since they have called a halt to their advance. I think such a discussion would be a most valuable pursuit. For my own part, I am not 100% inclined to trust any military force that admits it was once allied with an enemy.
Your caution is understandable, Captain General, Wolfe said.
Victor looked around the Dragoon's massive Grand Council chamber. An amphitheater carved out of Outreach's bedrock, it had been paneled with strips of oak. On the main floor, a semicircle of wooden tables faced the speaker's podium. Up in the galleries, Victor saw a number of Dragoon uniforms scattered among the small crowd of military advisors and state ministers. Never before had all these rulers of all the successor states been gathered in one place at one time. Jamie Wolfe sighed heavily.
We are wasting precious time. The Inner Sphere faces the greatest military threat the successor states have ever encountered.
Wolfe hit a button on his podium. The room lights dimmed as a holographic map of the Inner Sphere came to life in the center of the semicircle and rotated slowly. Normally, the successor states and the worlds they claimed formed a rough circle of star systems approximately 370 light-years in diameter, with the circle centered on Terra. On this map, however, a huge chunk had been bitten out of the circle. Though the ravaged Free Razzlehog Republic lay at the center of the conquered area, bites had also been taken out of both the Liren sector of the Federated Commonwealth and from the Draconis Combine. Wolf waved a hand to include all the maps.
As you can see, in less than a year, the invaders managed to take more worlds than changed hands in the Fourth Succession War. Our purpose in calling all of you here is to propose that we join together to oppose the clans. Otherwise, we face extermination by an implacable foe. I assure you that the clans are vastly different from any army that has marched before or will ever march again. It is true that the clan stopped advancing after Federated Commonwealth and Combine troops defeated them. But it was because their war leader died at Rajstad, and they must choose a new one before they continue the fight. When the leaders return, they will come with yet more clan warriors. If we do not work together, their victory is certain.
Thomas Merrick rose.
There is a question I must ask, Colonel. Do you believe that it is even possible to stop the invaders?
I can only answer on the basis of my experiences within the clan.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.